Hello, everyone. Thanks for listening to my podcast, Here to Learn. I'm Matt Edwards, and I'm a math teacher at Millbrook High School in Raleigh, North Carolina. These are my conversations with people with interesting perspectives on topics in education today. In this episode, I speak to a current Millbrook High student named Austin. She has finished her junior year. She is part of our International Baccalaureate Program, a rigorous course of study that challenges students to be well-rounded in their perspectives as well as their learning process. She's a member of the varsity soccer team and plays very competitive soccer outside of school. This conversation is about where she is today in her learning journey and how the pressures and expectations affect her. I find her fascinating and quite articulate. I hope you enjoy our chat. Kids weigh the size of their to-do list and time they put into that to-do list with somehow keeping their sanity and wits about them?
I'm not sure. I think for like Ivy kids, like my friends and stuff, like some people, like people like me that get really stressed, it's a thing where you got to figure out like how hard can you really push yourself until it's like, whoa, that's just too far beyond, like, okay, that's too far beyond, like, not good. Mm-hmm. You need to reel it back in. But there's also, I have friends that, like, it just doesn't affect them in the same way.
Right.
So they don't worry about that kind of stuff. But I definitely know, just because of how women's soccer recruiting is, and, like, I don't think I can say for my friends, like, at Millbrook, or even on my team, but like we don't talk that much like about individual recruiting experiences on my club team. But like I can't think of one of my friends that have been this invested in finding out where they're going to college from like the earliest point that I was. Like the second I stepped foot into high school, it was where am I going to college?
Yeah.
Which is intense.
It is intense.
And it's weird because, you know, I've been doing it for so long now, and then just like the past couple months, it just like snowballed, and it was like, oh my gosh, it's all happening right now. With like within weeks, it's like, oh my gosh, I'm too late, you know. Which is so weird because, you know, you spend like 3 years figuring out what you want, and then in the matter of like 4 or 5 days, it could all be different.
Well, let's go back a little bit. So you talked about how like pretty much since you got into high school that you've been thinking about, all right, the next stage is college. What am I going to do? Where am I going to go? How much would you say that thinking and that, I'm going to use the word stress if that's an appropriate jump in there, how much has that affected you physically, would you say?
Like figuring out where I want to go.
Yeah.
So set on my future. It's definitely been hard. I think at the beginning of the process, like my freshman, sophomore year, it was really fun. And it was just, like, an exciting thing, especially my cousin and I. She plays softball, but she wasn't really looking to play in college. We went on, like, this big road trip to, like, look at all these colleges over my sophomore spring break. And that was exciting. And that's when I visited Bucknell for the first time. And my freshman and sophomore year, that was like, ooh, that's where I want to go. Like, that's what I'm going to do kind of thing. And I was convinced, you know, like, this is the dream school. This is what we want. And that was like an excitement thing, and that summer I went to their camp and I had a great time and I loved the coach and all that. So like there's excitement in it at the beginning, like that's for sure, and it's not a totally horrible process all the time. But you know, sending those emails, figuring out, like putting yourself out there is just really, really hard, especially, and it's even worse now, they just changed the rule for when coaches can talk to younger players. It used to be you just can't respond to like freshman, sophomore, but now it's like you can't respond to a junior until June 15th, like after their junior year.
Right.
No, sorry, before their junior year. I don't know. Anyway, it's weird. They're just trying to slow everything down, which
that's
is
good. I think that's a great thing.
Oh, for sure.
It's a great thing.
It's crazy how some schools recruit, but like putting yourself out there knowing that you're not going to get a response is super hard. Like, knowing that, like, I'm just going to send out these emails, I'm going to introduce myself to a coach, be like, hey, can you come to my game, and then never know if they showed up, never know if they even looked at your email. Like, you just have no idea. And, like, you get used to it once you start emailing a lot of schools, but I was not the kind of player that was out here trying to email every school.
Right.
I mean, the max I probably ever got up to was, like, 12.
Mm-hmm.
Just because I knew not every school was for me. And I think that saved me a little bit. But I was also the kind of person, you know, once I sent about 2 or 3 emails, I got to the age where they could start responding to me, and I wasn't getting any sort of response. I was very quick to be like, okay, we got to move on. Like, don't get your hopes up.
Right.
And I think for me, that probably saved me a little bit of, like, heartache and stress. But I think for other people where they're like, no, I am going here. I don't care if you don't respond to me. You know, it works out for them, and that's great. But I couldn't do that to myself. So, like, I stuck with the ones that I really wanted, and I tried to do that, like, hard thing where it was, like, get it in, tell them who you are, make sure they see your name so much that they can't ignore you kind of thing. And, I mean, it's hard. It's definitely hard. For me, I think this may be, like, a generational thing, too. We don't email. Like, that's just not a thing that, like, people my age do very often. But because of that, to me, emails are really formal.
Mm.
Like, I can't send a casual email. If I'm going to, it's going to be a text.
Right.
Just because of
right.
the nature of
right.
it. So, emails to me, I knew if I was sitting down to write an email, it was a big deal. No matter what I was doing. If it was, like, for a job, like, talking to any adult, like, anything like that. But especially, like, recruiting. So, like, I had to set a time because I didn't want to do it. It's not something I liked doing because, you know, I would read the email 12 times before I sent it and all that.
Right.
And it got to the point where, like, I had to stop, like, asking people to read over it because it was just, it was too much. Like, it's like, Austin, at this point, you just need to be able to send your own emails kind of thing. But I would have to block out a time to sit down, beat out all of these emails, and it would be upwards of, like, 10 at a time, just, you know, keeping my coach updated, like, going to the college coach, just, like, everything I need to get done, had to get it done right then. And it would just be this, like, overload of, like, stress in that moment. But, like, once it was done, it felt great. I was like, got all those emails out, we're good. But then it was just like, it would come again because, you know, you got to write more. So I don't know, that part was hard for me for sure. And that was a thing, I think that was hard for, like, my parents to understand.
Yeah.
Because, you know, for them it's like, oh, it's just an email, Austin, like, just go
right,
just go
right,
write that email.
Right,
I do
right.
that every day. But for me, that was like, I knew as soon as I opened my laptop and I was like typing them out and I had, like, mail open, I was like, it's real.
Yeah.
Can't
yeah.
screw this up. So
I think that's so funny. I've gotten a couple of emails from current soccer players at Millbrook recently, and their emails are so incredibly formal.
Yeah.
I get so many, like, sirs, and I was like, all right, man, this is not like a paper you're turning in, but I think when I hear you say it, that's such an interesting thing. All right, I want to paint a little bit of a picture of who you are, because we've talked a lot about soccer and soccer recruiting, and that's very much something that's right here in your life right now. But what's amazing to me is that you also have a huge other piece of your life, and that's your academic world. So let's just talk a little bit about, you came to Millbrook. What kind of student were you? What kind of decisions were you starting to make? Along with this soccer that you play at a pretty high level outside of school and then have been a varsity soccer player since you've been here as a freshman. So let's talk a little bit about yourself as an academic student.
Okay. So I actually went to a charter school for 3rd through 8th grade. I went to Magellan Charter. And I think that made a huge impact on me as a student. Just the way that they focused. So I actually never had an elective at Magellan, which is a weird thing coming into Millbrook. But it made me realize how much that was infused into what we were doing. Like, you know, I realized, like, how many art projects I was doing in my history class. So I think that just made me a very, like, versatile, outside-the-box thinker from the beginning. And it also made me, like, crave, like, a challenge. And to be challenged critically, like, I wanted to be thinking about things in a different way and really, really understand things. So my freshman year, I, of course, tried to take the hardest classes I could. I think I had, in every class that I could have an honors class, I had an honors class. At the time, we were not allowed to take APs. I think they opened that up to them last year. But I think that's probably okay that I wasn't allowed to, because I would have tried.
Agreed.
I would have tried to do too much. But, yeah, I really, it was a really weird transition for me. I think where I had, because it's first with the 8AB day and just, like, all that, but just how different the academics were. Like, there was such a focus in one class on one thing, which was weird to me because I was so used to, like, cross-curricular stuff happening all the time. And I think that showed up a little bit more my sophomore year when I was taking APs, because I think they try to fuse those together a little bit more. Like, I'd be talking about stuff in APs and AP Human Geography. Like, those would match up, and that was cool. But, yeah, so I think I found, strangely enough, that one of my favorite, on opposite ends of the spectrum, my favorite classes freshman year were, like, gym and Latin.
Okay. So why gym?
Gym because it was a nice release. I'm an athletic person, so, like, being around, moving around, fitness stuff is really good for my brain. It just releases all that stress. And it was something I didn't have in middle school because we didn't have gym or anything like that. And, like, yeah, it was kind of a pain sometimes, and, like, most people don't like gym, so, like, they didn't want to be there. You know, you never want to be around people that don't want to be there. But, I don't know. It was really fun for me. It was just a fun thing, and I was like, whoa, like, I get to do this in school. Like, this
I felt the same way. Oh, yeah. It's amazing. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And I wasn't expecting it either. Like, I wasn't expecting to like it as much as I did, but at the end of the year, I was thinking, it was like, yeah, so, you know, like, Latin's, like, very methodical. Like, I love that my brain just clicks when I get something. I love the structure of it. I love the structure of the class, like, all that. And then it was, like, on the opposite end of the spectrum. I was like, I love the freedom and, like, the fun of gym, you know? So that was cool. But I definitely worked very hard. I've never gotten a B, like, final grade ever in my life.
Is that important to you?
That is important to me.
Why is that important to you?
When I was younger, I thought very much so that that was a reflection of how smart I was. Mm-hmm. I understand that's not how it is now. But because I, like, set that standard for myself, at this point, I think it's a show of how hard I work. I mean, also how well I understand material. Because, you know, to an extent, like, you can only work so hard to, like, understand something before you might need help. Or, like, you just, it's not for you, which is fine. But it's important to me to maintain a standard that I've set for myself. And just because that was one that kind of came along, it's one that I hope to maintain. And it's not the end of the world to me if I get a B. Like, I understand that, like, if I did everything I could, that's just how things work out, and I'm not gonna be, like, super upset with myself. It's just how things go. Percentages are weird and how stuff is weighted and all that. But it's just, for me at this point, it's a show of, like, how much effort I put into that class, how much effort I put into myself, like, believing that I could get that done.
Have you ever put in what you felt like was the right amount, the appropriate amount, the A level amount of effort, and then not gotten the A out of it? I know you said you've never gotten an A in a final grade, but what, you know, I'm talking papers, I'm talking projects.
100%. Sometimes that's just a matter of, like, what a teacher wants and what I think a teacher wants. Sometimes that's a matter of the structure of the class, if it doesn't suit me well. Sometimes it's just like, wow, Austin, that wasn't your thing. Like, you did everything you could, and you studied as much as you possibly could have handled. You know, you didn't wait till the last second to try to understand things, like, the whole time you were trying to figure it out. And sometimes, you know, like, you just don't get it. And it happens, and it's so frustrating. So, so frustrating.
When you say it's frustrating, how does it, you know, let's dig into that a little bit. What does it look like on you? Are you a crabby person? Is it hard to be around you? Do you go back to the teacher and question their rubric or their grading? Or do you go off by yourself and kind of sulk? What does it look like when you are disappointed in the result?
So, I think I can remember a specific example. For math, because math is, like, you can't argue math. Math is just math.
Oh, you'd be amazed. I have students that argue it.
Well, I understand that, like, there's just one answer there. So I don't try to argue that. Those kind of things just make me feel really defeated. I remember there was, like, a grade recovery thing. So, you know, it's, like, where it, like, replaces your lowest grade. And I needed a certain percentage on it to get an A for that, like, quarter or whatever. And I had worked so hard. I had talked to my teacher. I was, like, looking at old tests, figuring out what I didn't know. And I was going in, and I felt good. Like, it wasn't like I was sitting there and I was like, like, I don't know any of this. Like, I felt good while I was taking it. And it was one of those where it wasn't a Scantron thing, but it was like one of those instant results kind of thing. And so, she, you know, I'm sitting there. I'm the only one in the classroom. And she tells me, she's like, you didn't get it. And I just felt like, gosh, I was probably like the blood just rushed out of my face. And I just felt like I could just like puddle on the floor.
Mm.
Like, it was just like, ugh. Gut punch. And that's like, that's one way that I usually react, is like when I just feel like I've done absolutely everything I can and it still just wasn't quite enough, you know. That's probably like the most defeating. But then I've also had like papers and stuff where, or like a lab report or something, where I'm like, no, like, read this part again, and like, I like promise if you just read it again you'll see what I'm saying. And they do. And then it's like, that feels good. That's like, I advocated for myself.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And I got the points that I thought I deserved. And I also understand if I go back and I'm like, this is how I see this. This is why I believe, you know, I deserve those points. And they're like, well, this is why I didn't give them to you. And I understand their side. I'm like, okay, that's fair. We just have different opinions about it. And, you know, they get the last say. They're the teacher.
Right, right.
And I'm okay with that. I'm not going to keep going with it, because that's not going to make anyone happy.
Right.
So I think I know my boundaries when to argue for it, but I'm definitely not one to just sit back and be like, think to myself, like, oh, you worked so hard for this, and they're just screwing you over. They're not appreciating how much work you put in. Like, I'll have a conversation about it.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, when it's, like, the end all with, like, a test like that, like, it wasn't pre-calc, you know, there's nothing I could do at that point. And so, like, yeah, I was super bummed out for that afternoon. I was just kind of sad. But then I think I probably saw a friend, or I went to soccer practice or something like that, and I was like, you know what? Can't do anything about it now. You got next quarter. Just try harder. And I think that's something, as I've gotten older, I've gotten much better at doing.
Do you have any fear that that is in you about disappointing someone or disappointing yourself? I mean, I think you hold yourself to an incredibly high standard just from what we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any fear that then shows up at weird times?
I think probably as far as like school and soccer go, I think those are more personal standards that I hold. It's definitely it's a family thing too. But I think even I hold myself to a higher standard than my parents do. I think because of that, you know, they'd be pretty much proud of me no matter what I did.
Mm-hmm.
But for there, yeah, mostly that's just a me standard. But like with my friends, like stuff like that, there's definitely a disappointment there, like letting my friends down, like being too wrapped up in my own stuff that's going on to like not be there for them.
Mm-hmm.
So that's, I worry about that a lot. And sometimes that'll come up weird and they'll be like, Austin, whoa, you're good.
Mm-hmm.
Like, we're all
mm-hmm.
good. I'm like, no, you don't understand. Like, I need to be here for you. But yeah, for myself, I think because I hold that personal standard, and it may not be as obvious, especially to like kids my age.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it'll be weird when I like freak out about something, like, oh my gosh, no, like we can't do that right now. We can do that right now. Or like, I'm just like, okay, I need a second. Or another thing is like things that I think I need to handle myself that are like my issues to deal with, I don't necessarily talk about as much to my friends. And so when it's something I'm dealing with and I'm like really like not okay about it, they'll be like, oh, what's going on? I'm like, no, you weren't there the whole time. You don't need to be there. Like, this is not your thing. And then they're, like, hurt by that. And I'm like, no, it's not about you. This is me. I just need it to stay in the bubble. You know, sometimes it pops, and that's just a whole mess. But,
yeah,
I think sometimes it does come out in weird ways, and it's just, like, a random, like, whew, Austin, you good? And I'm like, no, not really, but I will be.
So. Yeah. Well, something that I want to talk to you a little bit about as well is you know, something that you kind of brought into my life as a coach and a teacher that I've experienced with you a little bit, and I hope it's okay to talk about, is a little bit about the anxiety that not just you have experienced in your life, but some of your peers. It's something that teachers are being made more and more aware of now. I think in general we're more aware of it. I think when I was growing up, it was there. We just didn't know what to call it.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times it was just the try harder. Just try harder.
Yeah.
Just deal with it. You'll be fine. But I want to talk a little bit about that. You know, I've been there with you when you've had a moment. So that's kind of the first part. I just kind of want you to talk a little bit about maybe where that comes from or what happens in those few moments where you feel like you either had an attack or you felt it coming. And then I want to talk a little bit about just kind of maybe some things that you maybe have experienced by being a friend.
Okay, so I guess I can start with like where it first showed up for me. It was probably in middle school, and it was probably one of the weirdest experiences of my life because I had no idea what was happening. And it was just a lot of stuff like piled on, and I couldn't even tell you what it is now because it doesn't seem important anymore. But you know, it was just like, whoa, like there's so much coming at me right now. And I just kind of like curled up in a ball, and everyone was like, oh my gosh, is she okay? And I was like, I don't know. And I eventually caught my breath and it was fine, but I was like very shaky, like my hands had locked up in this weird position. It was weird. So that was scary, and after that it just like didn't really go away, but it wasn't a constant thing for me either. And I found, lucky enough for me, it isn't something that plagues me as much school-wise. I definitely get stressed, but I'm better at handling it in school, I think, because I have time to like breathe and like take a second and be like, you're gonna be okay. But for sports, it's definitely been a thing that's come up a lot, just because I think, one, I get a very emotionally attached and driven in a game, or in practice, or just anything like that, just because the whole thing means so much to me. Like, I'm competitive, I care about my teammates a lot, I care about the score, but I also care about how we play. Like, there's just so many aspects that are happening all at once, and with soccer, it's a very high-speed game. I play in a position where there's just a lot of pressure because, you know, you're that last line of defense, and I worry, even before what happened with Caroline, I've always been very worried about my keepers.
You're talking about our teammate that got injured earlier this year.
So, but even before that, like before I've ever seen any sort of injury with a keeper, like I've been very protective just because of who I am. And so I would never want to leave them in a position where like they, not even like to get hurt, but like would have to completely throw themselves out there for a save or something like that. So there's pressure there. And then I also have what we think is like exercise-induced asthma. So if like I'm very emotionally driven on top of running around like a crazy person and just like not getting enough time to think or breathe or anything, I'll just like stop breathing, or I'll start wheezing or something like that. And once it hits like a certain point, I can't stop it. Like there's no going back. And so that'll be a thing. And it's a really hard thing to recover from, I think, is the problem.
Right.
For me. Because, you know, otherwise it would just be like, breathe, start again, and you're good. But when you have that emotional factor in there, it just like takes a whole nother round of like, you're going to be okay, like that kind of thing. So I have an inhaler now, which is sometimes helpful, but it also makes your heart beat really fast, which is not good for anxiety. But yeah, so I've had to come off the field during games, and just kind of sit there with like my head between my knees and like nobody really talked to me, just like need to like regain myself. And it's taken like 30 minutes before for me to try to figure out what's going on. But there's also been times where, like, it happens, and then I jump right back in, and I'm okay. Like, I can play, but the problem is that emotional, like, instability doesn't leave. So even if I'm starting to move better, and, like, I don't feel bad anymore, like, physically, I'm okay. Like, emotionally, or even if I've, like, emotionally calmed down, that, like, shakiness and that, like, instability that I feel, like, inside can so easily be triggered. Like, I can remember one time at practice, I don't even remember, I think it was, I want to say it was my sophomore year, and it was, I had just tried out for ECNL before I had ever made the team, and, you know, I knew my call was coming that day, and I had no idea when it was coming, and, you know, stuff like that is just stressful, and I knew it wasn't going to come while I was at practice, but it was just the thought of it being there, and I was exhausted, because I probably hadn't slept the night before thinking about it, and, like, stuff like that. All that plus a full day of school, who knows what could have happened in that day. Like, and we were just doing a drill, and it was one of those drills where it was like a high intensity transition game, and I would just like was running around in circles because in those games, I'm not the kind of person that will be like, oh, you know, I've been in every time, like, somebody else needs to go. It was like, oh, gosh.
Somebody needs to go. I'm on this. I'm the one.
Yeah, the ball went to the other side. I got to get over there.
I got to get over there, yeah.
So, you know, I've been doing that a lot. And I just, like, felt it was, like, one of those, like, defeated moments. Like, the ball just kept going around me because either, like, the second player wasn't coming in or I wasn't stepping at the right time because I was so in my own head. And it was just like, whoa, 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 whoa. And then it just, and I was on the ground and everyone was like, oh my gosh, she's on the ground. What's going on? I was like, I don't know. But yeah, that was one of those where like, yeah, I needed a second and I like sat on the side and I figured it out and I got water and everything. And I came back and like emotionally I had calmed down. Like I felt much better. I was like, you're freaking out over nothing you can control right now. So just chill out and practice. This is what you love to do. Like, this is your release. Like, don't take that away from yourself. But like, my hands were still shaking and I still felt that like my heart was still like kind of weird. Like, it was just a whole thing. So like, we were playing that same game and I was running around. I was like, we just need to not play this game right now. So I just waited and then we did a possession game and I was fine. But it was like, it's one of those really weird things. Like, even once I've like emotionally calmed down, if like someone comes up to me and like asks me like what's going on, like what's happening to me right now, or like I go to like play the game again or something like that, it's just like it can trigger it so easily. I'm like, you're not even upset anymore. Why are you doing this to yourself?
Right.
But yeah, it's one of those weird things where like the emotional side of it and the physical side gets so connected that you like, even if one is better, like the other one can't quite like separate itself enough.
Let's go a little bit bigger picture here, and let's talk a little bit about some of your classmates or friends or just people you've been around. One of the things that teachers would love to be able to do is to be able to look for a specific thing that says, ooh, that person's suffering from anxiety, or when this happens, I need to do this. And my little bit of experience and my big fear is that not only is it different for everybody, but the person that the anxiety affects, it's not like there's a ton of warning signs.
Yeah.
Talk to me a little bit about, you know, some of the people you've been around and how it's kind of affected them, and then maybe what are some things that might help them? I mean, it sounds like you do a lot of just turning into yourself, talking to yourself, internal monologue, calming yourself down, running through kind of your checklist of things that matter and priorities. I don't know that a lot of people are as self-aware as you are. So talk to me a little bit about what you've experienced through other people and maybe some things that we can just kind of pinpoint that might have eased a moment.
So for, I guess, advice I would give to like teachers in that situation or coaches, one is like, you don't need to understand it like completely as they do. Like, you don't need to know why it happens to them, I think, necessarily, or even need to know what they're feeling in that moment to be able to be there for them. I think one thing that adults do is that like they feel the need to be like, I need to know exactly what's happening to them right now. I need to know everything they're thinking so that I can help them in like every way. But like, they don't even know what they're thinking. So that's really hard for another person to know what they're thinking. I think just being understanding, at least, it definitely is different for every person. For me, it's like an understanding that like, I need a second. Like, I promise I'm gonna be fine, but I just need a second. And also, I had one coach, he wasn't like coaching me at the time, but was like a coach around, didn't understand, like had never seen someone have an anxiety attack before, anything like that. And he just like had a lot of questions and tried to make really light of it, which in some cases was really good because, you know, like I don't need it to be that deep all the time. Like, it's okay, like to talk about it lightly, but it definitely didn't make me feel better. And he was like, oh, so you just like can't breathe? Like, maybe you should try to do that better. And I was like, that's not what I wanted to do right now. So definitely, like, one, don't make, for me, because I value like my strength, like I may be different for other people, but I don't think anybody wants to be told that like they're weak or like this makes them weak
or you should just do this better.
Right
Like they didn't already know that.
Right. Like, I definitely try to breathe like a normal human. Like, that's my goal. But yeah, so that, and then I think, I guess, just be really open about it. I think if students know that it's, like, okay to be a little freaked out or, like, have their moment around an adult, I'm not going to say, like, it'll happen more often because you don't control when it happens, but, like, they'll be less freaked out about it when it's happening. They'll be like, oh, there's people around here that, like, care about me and support me, so, like, I'm going to be okay.
Right.
So, like, feeling that support without, like, necessarily, like, actually feeling, like, someone's hand on your back or, like, something like that. I'm not the one to say how you can try to figure out who is and who isn't affected. I think, one, because everyone's affected in their own way, but some people are very quiet about it.
Right.
And if it just never comes up when you're around, you'll never know.
Right.
As far as my friends go, I see a lot of them. They're more stressed, I want to say, than anxious.
Mm-hmm.
Which can go hand in hand. I don't get as stressed. I get more anxious. And I think that's something that's, like, anxiety is something harder to talk yourself out of. Because it's such a, like, physical feeling. It's, like, bubbling up in your chest, and you're like, whoa, there's so much energy in here. That you just, like, don't know what to do with. But with stress, I think that's an important thing to be supportive of, too, is, like, acknowledge it. Like, tell your students, like, I know you're stressed. I know I am contributing to that stress. It's not purposeful. Like, I don't want you to be stressed. But, like, this is how it is. If you need help, I'm here. I have a teacher like that did that this year.
Oh, good.
And he was, like, saying, he would ask us, like, before tests and stuff. He'd be like, are you guys stressed?
He would ask you before a test if you were stressed?
Uh-huh. And we'd all
be and would you ever just say, this is a piece of cake?
Nope. Everyone would be like, yeah, we're stressed.
Of course.
And he'd be like, don't be stressed. It's all going to be okay. And, you know, like, sometimes I believed him. Other times I was like, you're playing me right now.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know. But it was still nice to know that he at least acknowledged it, even if he was contributing to, like, the big portion of the stress in that moment. I think it's different for every person being supportive, too, not just the person that needs to be supportive. Like, I don't know. Like, for me, there's certain people in my life that, like, yeah, I want them to be, like, sitting right beside me when I'm not doing well and, like, giving me that pat on the back, being like, it's going to be okay, you know. But I also have, like people in my life that, you know, just, like, a text, like, hey, you didn't look that great today. Do you want to talk about it? And I can say no, but, like, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for noticing.
Yeah.
And they're like, okay, like, I'm
sometimes just having somebody notice that you were a little bit off means the world, because it means that you actually mattered.
Right.
Oh, I fear that so many of my students float through life and people, or their fear or their sense or the way that they, like, perceive the world is that nobody notices them.
Mm-hmm.
And I, you know, when I get into my to-do list, I mean, chances are I'm just adding to that.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm having students' faces flash into my head right now that are totally slipped through the cracks people.
Mm-hmm.
And that's just, as a teacher, that's kind of scary.
Yeah.
You know, so I think that it's great for you to be able to, like I said, be self-aware of some of these things. But I also really hope that as teachers we can continue to be able to get to that place that you just said, to say it's okay to feel like this in front of me, it's okay to feel stress right now. You know, I think that that's a really important thing for someone, adult or child, student or teacher, to be told that it's okay to feel what you're feeling right now. You're not a weirdo. You're not, you know, there's not something wrong with you. And I think when we do the whole social emotional education, which is a big thing in not only Millbrook High School, but Wake County right now, is being able to create an environment where people feel okay to feel what they feel. And I don't know that Wake County is able to say it as much like that as they want to, but that's an important thing, I think, for me, and that I think that you're kind of saying is give me an environment where I'm not afraid to feel less than perfect. And I think that that's a really important, super important thing, actually. So we've talked a little bit about, you know, some of your coping strategies and wisdom that you can offer teachers and students. What would you offer? You know, you talked a little bit about what you want teachers to know. What would you say to kids?
For kids, I think.
Kids being your peers, kids being, you know, students, really just close to where you are in your life and your journey right now. What would you say to them?
I think as like a general thing, like doesn't matter what sport you play, doesn't matter what level classes you take, like just being a human, like I think you need to understand that you're not alone. Because I know how supportive my family is and my friends are. Like I have such a good support system around me and I put myself in really good environments of people. And still I feel like, no, this is my thing to handle. I have to do this by myself. And that's just not the case, like, ever. It can be, like, I decide, or any person can decide that, like, this is just something they want to deal with by themselves, and that's okay. But the second it feels just a little too much, even if it seems like it'd be insignificant to anyone else, I would say something. Like, I encourage people to say something. And it may just be, like, in passing conversation to a friend, because I know the problem that I end up with is I tell myself until I absolutely can't handle it, and I'm like mental breakdown stage. That's when I have to tell someone because I can't do it anymore. And they're like, I don't understand. Like, I don't know what's going on because I haven't told them the whole time. Like, they may not even know this thing is happening in my life. And I think that's not healthy for anyone because then they don't even, I mean, they can help you and they can tell you they love mm-hmm. you and that mm-hmm. like it's all going to be okay, but they don't know how the thing has been going. And it's not fair of them to like, or fair of you to expect them to understand.
Right, right.
So I think it's one of those, like, it's okay, like, even if, like, you think you're okay, but, like, you're a little worried that it could become a thing that you need to deal with someone else and not just by yourself, like, just mention it. Be like, hey, this thing is going on, and, like, I'm good, but, like, I really love if you could be in this with me.
Right.
Wherever this right. may go. And then if it turns out really great, you both went on this really great journey together, and they were there for your highs, too. So I think that's a thing I would definitely recommend. Like, don't ever let yourself believe that you are alone in it. And if you truly are, which I hopefully doubt that someone really is truly alone and doesn't have a single person they could talk to, you can find someone. Like, find a teacher or a peer. Like, someone just, like, seems like you can just sense a little bit like openness, acceptance, care, compassion, something, and I'm sure that it'll blossom into something
right
really good.
Right.
So just like don't be afraid either to say something to the people you already have or to like just go that little extra step to like find someone so you can have that person to say
because there's just so little of a chance that no one feels a piece of what you're feeling.
For sure.
I mean, we all have something that does that. I have no idea what this is doing to my body feeling,
mm-hmm.
and that the empathy will be there on some part. But I tell you, I think that's wonderful advice. When I hear you say that, I know the thing that keeps people is that risk of putting yourself out there. And you've talked about that a couple times today. Who is your person? Do you have a person that's like your? I start with them, and if it's not them, like your phone tree of support.
Mm-hmm. Depending on the situation, but usually I go to my best friend first,
mm-hmm.
Abigail. She's just, we're very in the like we're there for each other no mm-hmm. matter what it is, which is just really nice to have. And she's like always just a text or a phone call away, and she lives like 5 minutes from me, so you know she can drive over or I can drive over mm-hmm. if I need something. But there's some things like I'm the kind of person, if I know that Abigail's dealing with something, I don't want to put my stuff on her mm-hmm. at that moment, because I know if it was me, like I of course would help her, but that's like I care about her a lot and I know how much she cares about me. And like your own like thing that you're dealing with, plus then you're like really upset because your best friend is dealing with something too,
right?
That's just, it's not healthy for either of you. So one, if I don't want to put something on her, or if it's just like a different situation that maybe I think she wouldn't understand just as well, just because she hasn't known me mm-hmm. as long, like I definitely talk to my sister.
Yeah.
She's been there my entire life, mm-hmm. literally, and she knows me really well. And it also helps at this point that she's a bit more separated from my life.
Because she's away at college.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So she hasn't lived at home for 2 years now, which has been a weird thing. It's also been weird to have her back, too.
Right.
But she's actually gone for the summer again. So, yeah, it's nice to, like, have someone who's, like, attached to my hip because she knows exactly what's going on and everything. But there's also, you know, the person that, like, I don't see all the time. Like, it's maybe been months since I've seen her because she can just completely be objective to the entire thing and tell me how she really feels about it while still knowing me and knowing, like, what I should probably do. So I think that's another, like, skill that you eventually learn is figuring out the right person to talk to when you do have such a broad support system like that. But, yeah.
Well, that's, I really appreciate you digging into that. I mean, that's a sensitive topic. That's something that, you know, it's hard to put words to. That feeling is such a out-of-body experience, and the not really being able to articulate what's happening to you. I mean, I've been lucky that it's only happened to me like once in my life, but that little bit is plenty.
Right.
It's plenty. A lighter note, is there anything in particular that you are listening to or watching right now that's just kind of like got you jazzed up for the summer or helps you kind of focus on whatever?
Unfortunately, I was an avid reader as a kid, but I don't read as much anymore just because I have a lot of schoolwork and soccer and travel, but I wish I did. But one thing that's been kind of funny and interesting for me is that I've been writing my EE, my extended essay that we do at the IB program here. And you get to pick your topic. So I'm doing it about criminal profiling because that's really interesting to me. So one of my books that I'm using for research is actually it's a lot more of a narrative, honestly. And it's like telling the story of one of the cases that I'm studying versus just like a listing out of the facts like you would find on like history.com or something like that. And it's really interesting, and I enjoy that. It's called Incendiary, and it's about the New York mad bomber, George Metzke. So if you like Criminal Minds or NCIS or just, you know, general case studies or studying cases of, like, serial killers, that's a good one. It's very interesting. But, yeah.
So you have interest in these criminal case studies because that's something that you're interested in later on, or it's just fun right now?
It's definitely what I'm interested in doing, like, with my life. I'm actually going to a CSI and law camp this summer to, like, see what that looks like in the real world. Like, guest speakers come from, like, the FBI and, like, CSI to, like, talk to us, and we do labs and we do, like, court simulations and like all that stuff, and I'm really excited to see what that looks like because that's not something, you know, I can really study like in a class.
I've
really seen in a classroom setting, and as I've been doing this recruiting process, I've talked to a lot of professors trying to figure out what, you know, my academic career looks like at their school, and it'll probably lead me some sort of sociology degree, a criminology major, or a like law and justice kind of thing. And it was funny because I was talking to my dad at the hotel in D.C. this weekend about how strange it was. Like, there are very few kids that grow up to do what they thought they were going to do.
Oh, my goodness. Like, absolutely.
I can think of maybe, like, one little girl that, like, wanted to be a veterinarian that, like, actually did it among the, like, 60 that, you know, said in second grade class, like, hey, I want to be a veterinarian.
That's right.
But, I mean, ever since I was little, like, I thought I wanted to be, like, a police officer, some sort of law enforcement, which is so weird, because, you know, as I got older, I was like, you're crazy. It's definitely not what you want to do, but, you know, here I am, like, coming full circle, and, like, I'm not going to be a police officer, but that's definitely, like, the area that I'm in, like, law and justice, that I'm looking into, and I found that really interesting.
I think that's so awesome, and what I love so much about it is that it's slightly unexpected because, you know, it's people see academically successful people. I mean, you're a junior marshal. You're one of our top ranked students here. Not that we really do class rank anymore. and so, like, everybody says a doctor.
Right.
Doctor. Every now and then you'll get engineer. But the fact that you want to challenge yourself not only digging into people's personalities and but also the service of law and justice is such a neat thing. So I'm really looking forward to how that, you know, progresses over the next few years. Because I definitely am thrilled about what you have to offer in a professional setting. Well, thank you for doing this. Thank you for your time. It's such a neat perspective. I've always admired how articulate you are and how thoughtful you are. I know that your teammates and your classmates are very aware of how much you care about them. And I think that that is such a unique and rare trait. You know, I think this time in our lives is very easy to be very selfish and very focused on us. And I don't think anybody would be mad at you if you were more focused on you. But the fact that you are this aware and supportive and you are that emotionally invested in those of us around you, we're grateful for it. So thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you.